Doing this morning. It's early. I'm Kathy Love. I am a pediatric diabetes educator here. I trained as a registered dietitian and worked for a decade at UCSF in the pediatric and neonatal intensive care unit. And then I came here 18 years ago and fell right into diabetes. And that's what I've been doing full time pretty much since the first couple of years I've been here. And so today I'm going to share with you information about diabetes and give you some updates on things that are a little bit newer. First, I want to introduce our team. So we have five physicians on staff at this time. At one point we were six. Other times we've been two or three, but right now we're a good full five MDs. And Jenny Olson is our medical director. You'll probably run into them in the emergency room as they come see patients there. We have five full-time diabetes educators as well. We are a mix of nurses and dietitians, but what we've done is cross-trained and we all do the same job. So even as a dietitian, I work with families, start them on pumps, do dose adjustments. We have a dose adjustment protocol, which I wrote. So we all do a variety of things for our patients. We have one nurse practitioner who sees some patients in clinic as well. So she has her own diabetes clinic, but it's just a piece of her job because she mostly does other endocrinopathies. We have three social workers, and there are two social work fellows every year as well. So we have good social services support. And our social workers are just priceless. They're really, really good. Inpatient, Katie Kraft is a child life specialist who works with our patients. She has intimate knowledge around diabetes and is a great asset. And then we have inpatient dietitians who do the inpatient nutrition teaching. So objectives, we're going to talk about type 1, type 2, insulins. And overall, we're also going to talk about care of the diabetes patient and what that looks like. And then some of the new technologies and a little bit about injection technique, because there's some new recommendations out as well. And then we'll also talk about acute complications of hypo and hyperglycemia. Can you hear me okay? So the first thing I think to start with is what is the diagnosis of diabetes? And anyone who's been around as long as I have knows that those criteria have changed. And what's also been more recently added are A1C levels as well. So a normal fasting plasma glucose without diabetes is less than 100. And any time after eating or random would be less than 140. For the diagnosis of diabetes, greater than or equal to 126 is diagnostic, and that's in a lab, not on a glucometer, because glucometers are not perfect. Anytime random or 2 hours after an OGTT or postprandial above 200 is considered diabetes as well. Now, anything in between that is a pre-diabetes state. Okay, so we used to say 4 to 6% would be a normal A1C, but that's actually not the case. So we know that for an A1C greater than 6.5 is diagnostic of diabetes. Between 5.7 and 6.4 is pre-diabetes, and 5.6 or less is considered a normal hemoglobin A1C. So we use all these parameters in conjunction. And most of our kids are type 1, and we rarely do OGTTs on that population. It's usually a more type 2 picture population where we do that procedure. It seems like we don't do it very often. There's many types of diabetes. These are a few. Certainly type 1 and type 2 are what we're going to focus on today, mostly type 1, but I'll bring up a little bit with type 2. We don't see gestational diabetes, Some of our kids get pregnant, and when they do, we send them to Sweet Success, which is a specialized pregnancy program for managing diabetes. Secondary forms we see quite a bit, and I'll talk about those in just a minute, and certainly other rare forms of diabetes as well. MODY is one, maturity onset diabetes of youth, and we occasionally see neonatal diabetes as well. So if you look at the big picture for diabetes in terms of type 1 versus type 2, 5% of all diabetes is type 1, 90% of all diabetes is type 2, and then you have 5%, which are these other forms of diabetes in between. And when we look at presentation of our population, about 30% of our type 1s are overweight, which mimics the general population, right? In terms of type 2, 85% are overweight. Now, with that said, that means that 15% of those with type 2 are not. So it's not all just related to weight. Symptoms for type 1 are usually much more prominent, so polyuria, polydipsia, weight loss, and DKA. Those symptoms may or may not be present in the presentation of type 2, but we do see DKA in type 2 diabetes, which is different from the general population of adults. DKA is much more rare in the adult population, but we do. And we may have a kid who comes in who looks like a patient who has type 2 that may very well be type 1, but may have other features or characteristics you might see in type 2. So we kind of go on the premise most of the time that it's type 1 until proven otherwise. Type 1 is autoimmune, whereby the immune system destroys the islet cells in the pancreas that make insulin. So it results in an absolute insulin deficiency. And we know that there are genetics involved, multiple genetics, but what we are not as certain about are what the triggers are. So certainly things like stress have been associated, and there are certain infections that have been associated with the triggering of type 1, but it really is much more vague than that. And treatment is replacing the insulin that someone with type 1 doesn't make, and carb counting. And I'll talk a little bit about the insulin regimen a little bit later and some of the insulin types in action. Type 2 is not autoimmune, but it's characterized by insulin resistance and also actually excessive hepatic gluconeogenesis. So the liver is pumping out sugar inappropriately in the bodies of people with type 2 diabetes. It is a progressive disease, and you can have beta cell destruction over time, and many people with type 2, at least 50%, ultimately have to go on to insulin for their treatment. We see it very strong in genetics. It runs in families. At least 75% of our kids who are diagnosed with type 2 have a first or second degree relative with type 2 diabetes. And it probably nears more closer to 100%, because type 2 diabetes can go unrecognized, especially in the adult population, for up to 5 to 10 years. And so if a child is actually diagnosed with type 2 diabetes and there isn't an immediate family member, they probably need to be screened. But we see it in our African American, Hispanic American, Pacific Islanders, Asians. It came across from the Asiatic, across the Bering Strait, in our Native Americans. So we see it in our peoples of color more so, disproportionately. And of course, treatment lifestyle changes. Our first line oral medication is metformin, which only works if the blood sugars and A1C are not grossly elevated. and certainly insulin as well. And in the adult arena, there are many, many, many type 2 drugs on the market right now. It just is exploding with treatment options. So what we see in the hospital is certainly new onset diabetes, and they come in usually through the emergency room, so you all are seeing those patients. Patients with known diabetes who are coming back in diabetic ketoacidosis. Sometimes we see severe hypoglycemia or prolonged hypoglycemia. There was someone, I think, yesterday with hypoglycemia who was admitted, probably from an insulin overdose, actually, by the parent, accidentally. And certainly kids who have diabetes who might be here for some other reason that's unrelated to diabetes. So they might have to have an appendectomy. We had a run of those in the past month or two, two or three appendectomies. Other acute illnesses, secondary forms of diabetes. So we see secondary due to medication-induced, like steroids or chemotherapeutic agents. Tacrolimus, so you might see we have had a long time liver transplant patient who was cycling in and out. She's aged out now. Certainly, thalassemia related and cystic fibrosis related are other forms of secondary types of diabetes. And then, many, even though psychosocial is not an admission diagnosis, we can't just admit for those types of purposes. But many of the readmissions of our known type 1s in DKA require a lot of psychosocial intervention. And all of our new onset patients receive the whole entire team. So we are a comprehensive team with the patient in the middle. And we have the diabetes educators, the physicians, dietitian, all the nurses. If you expand that to the greater community, it's family, friends, schools, etc., who are involved. So when we have a new onset patient, what is it that we do? So you start the stabilization process in the emergency department, and then if they're in DKA, they're admitted into the PICU for further stabilization to reverse the diabetic ketoacidosis. If they're not that sick, they go directly to the floor. Our physician does all of the inpatient management in terms of medical management. And our role as a diabetes educator is to do the rest. So we meet and greet families. Sometimes in the emergency room too, not as often, but we bring a bag and we have a Pink Panther book, or Understanding Diabetes, from the Barbara Davis Center in Denver, which is a big diabetes center. They have a small version which we provide to families in English and Spanish. We have. They also have a large version too. And then we have a binder with all of our information, so that they get everything that they need in paper, English and Spanish again, and we have some modified for other languages as well. So we provide this. We also give them a glucometer based on what their insurance is, and we teach them how to use that, and we give them a teddy bear, which even the teen boys like. It's very, very sweet. And so the process is that we provide resources. Certainly there's a lot of grief and shock initially, and families have to work through that. We also, the education is split up usually into three different sessions. So we call them day one, day two, day three. So day one might involve, you know, what is diabetes? Insulin types in action, how to use the glucometer, and then we set up a nutrition session where the inpatient dietitian does inpatient carb counting, usually, or if it's if it's known that they're going to be type 2, it'll be focused more on healthy eating. And then day three, day one nutrition and day two. So the second day, we focus more on hypo and hyperglycemia and how to manage that at home so that they have basic survival skills to manage at home. So this is just the beginning of their learning process. And in that time, the floor nurses teach families how to draw and inject insulin. So families have to be competent at doing that before they leave as well. We do the prescriptions, we do the school forms, and make discharge appointments, the first one being a diabetes educator appointment in 2 weeks after, and then a month after with the physician. And physician clinics include all of the diabetes, including diabetes educators as well. And certainly our social workers meet with the family child life as well. So that's kind of what they get when they're brand new. And then what you do in the emergency room is stabilize them medically, but another way that could be helpful is kind of helping families be set up for what they might expect, which is basically an admission for, 2 to 4 days typically, and that they'll be meeting with the whole team, and that the diabetes educator will meet with them and start education. And so it's important for the families to be at the bedside. We work Monday through Friday, so we meet with families only during that time period. But on the weekend, learning happens too, because they'll still get information from, they'll get the pack, this information from the physician, they can read, they can learn to draw and give insulin during that time too. So they're still learning, and often if they've been in it on the weekend, the teaching goes really fast because they've had a chance to process some of the learning and be more able to learn. For our known patients with diabetes who come in DKA, they're a much more complicated scenario. And so our plan of action is really based on what their needs are at the time. It often does involve re-education, and sometimes it's multiple re-educations over checking the blood sugar, checking for ketones, how to call urgently, what to do. And if families follow those instructions, they shouldn't end up landing in an emergency room with DKA. So then after new onset, or for all of our patients, what we do is have ongoing care. We see patients usually quarterly in clinic. We have point of care testing for A1C. Sometimes we see them more often than that. And in between visits, the diabetes educators do most of the day-to-day management. We have a CDE line where families call in for non-urgent things, which we often pick up. We have people dedicated to doing phone calls. We take the urgent calls Monday through Friday during work time. The physicians take them after hours. We make all the dose adjustments, sick day management, and it's not usually in a vacuum. We usually are, we're so close as a team that we do a lot of discussions so that we provide, make sure that what we're doing is good for the family. And at each visit, the point of care testing for A1C, we do vital signs, evaluate growth, and then yearly we do lab panels. We look for celiac disease, we look for thyroid, because those are other autoimmune conditions that come along with type 1. Right? Once one autoimmune, we are prone to more at risk for other autoimmune conditions. And we also at some point start to screen for lipids. Macrovascular disease is a major complication of diabetes later down the line. And we also start urine screening at some point as well. It's not initially, it varies with age and length of diagnosis. So insulin, this was the first insulin, it was Ivitin, and the first patient to be injected was Leonard Thompson. He was 14 at the time, and Banting Invest in Canada had discovered the insulin and took animal pancreases and kind of tried to purify it. And so he was the first one injected. He ended up with abscesses and infection, but his blood sugars went down. And he didn't die from the infection at that time. They went back to the lab and continued to purify it. For many, many years, you know, it was animal insulin, pork and bovine. He ended up living until he was 27 or 28 and died of pneumonia, but they didn't have antibiotics to prevent pneumonia. So, and if you were to see before and after pictures, the before treatment was starvation, and you either died of starvation or diabetic ketoacidosis. So it made a huge difference. And what you can expect for, for normal blood glucose is in a very, very tight range when you don't have diabetes. So we basically make insulin all the time when we're not eating. That's our basal requirement. And because our livers kick out sugar, our body makes sugar. So we always need insulin. And then for those of us without diabetes, we make surges of insulin, which you can see are kind of bimodal. And to maintain a very tight control of the blood sugar. So what we try to do when we make insulin plans is to mimic something that's closer to what's physiologic. And those of you who have been around a longer time also know that, you know, the insulins have changed vastly over the years in the regimen. We used to use MPH and regular, and then we started using rapid-acting analogs, Humalog first, and then Novolog, and now we have Apidra. So we have three rapid-acting insulins right now, and they work rapidly, and they're gone in 3 hours. So they ideally bring the sugar down fast, and they are great for prandial food coverage, carb coverage. And then the most common other insulin we use is a long-acting insulin, which most are good for about 24 hours. The most common you're going to see is Lantus and Levemir. And in the hospital, what we have on formulary is Novolog and Levemir. So that's what we use in the hospital. But families use a lot of the other ones outside of the hospital. Now, Lantus was the first brand, and not that long ago, Basaglar by a different company was approved, and it is also Glargine. So Glargine is Lantus or Basaglar, and now they're making things with higher concentrations. So Toujeo is Glargine that's 300 units per milliliter rather than 100. We're not using the Toujeo. It's probably useful in someone with type 2 who needs really large doses. But it is available. And then the newest one on the market, Degludec or Traceba, it's a very interesting insulin which we are starting to use. It also comes in different concentrations. We're using 100 units per mil. But what's different from that, and I'll just point out, Levemir probably has a little shorter duration of action than the other insulins. We still use it usually once a day, sometimes twice, but Traceba has a 42-hour action. It has a very unique property for the way it's absorbed. And so it's got a 42-hour action, and what's really nice about it is that if someone misses their dose, let's say you take a dose at night and you forget to do it, you can take the Traceba in the morning. And then you can take your usual dose 8 or more hours after that. So if you normally take it at 6 o'clock at night, you get up and take it at 8 a.m., then by 6 o'clock that night, you can take your normal dose. So it's a very unique insulin, and we're using it more and more with our kids that have DKA because it has a longer duration of action, and being able to do this kind of dosing with it may hopefully prevent some repeat DKAs. Certainly regular insulin we use as a drip, intermediate acting MPH we only use if we have to, and the premix we only use if we have to, so I'm not going to focus on them. They're just the last resort, frankly. And here's just another picture of the actions of the insulins. So our most common regimen is a basal bolus, where we give an injection of a long-acting insulin, often at dinner, but sometimes in the morning, and sometimes twice a day. Twice a day would usually be based on smaller doses, which may not last as long as the others, and then we prepare a rapid-acting insulin for carbs and then blood sugar correction. For delivery, certainly syringe and vial, and we have insulin pens, which are available. Some come with a cartridge like that that you fill. Others are pre-filled pens, which you dispose of at the end. There are 300 units in each of these, and 1,000 units in the vials. And then we have insulin pumps, and I'm going to do just a little brief thing on pumps. So one of the things, questions that has always come up with some of our families is what we teach in the do in the hospital isn't necessarily what they do at home. And the first being that for home use, we teach families that they don't need to use alcohol. Metoprolol is an ingredient in the insulin. It's an anti-infective agent. And so the risk of infection with injections is very low unless someone has an underlying immunodeficiency. So for the bulk of our patients, they don't need to use alcohol. It just dries and it stings. And for home use, they can keep insulin at room temperature, just not above 85, because when it's cold, it also stings. And it's stable at room temperature. What they aren't using, we recommend they keep in the refrigerator just as a more controlled. And certainly rotating within sites, they don't have to go back and forth from here to here to here to here. They can rotate within a site and use that. And sometimes they'll say, use your arm for a week, and then switch and use your other arm. And it's helpful if they can pick at least four places. Young kids tend to find a place, and that's all they're doing. And the problem with that is we end up with kids that have a lot of hypertrophy, where it gets very lumpy, and then that insulin isn't absorbed well. And it can reduce the absorption by at least 20%. And you can have spotty absorption, where sometimes it dumps in and other times it doesn't. So rotation is a really important aspect. And in the hospital, on the floor, and maybe in the emergency department too, we often do injections after eating because we're not sure how often, how much kids are going to eat. At home, we encourage it prior to eating and sometimes even 15 or more minutes before eating for any kid that we know what they're going to eat because it just works better. So, and then technique, 90-degree angle, and I'm going to show you, there's no pinch for pen needles. Pen needles are only four, but, so FITR is a, there was an international gathering where they evaluated injection technique literature and came up with expert recommendations. And the first one is to use the shortest needle possible. There was some concern, well, maybe someone who has more body weight, more adipose, should have a longer needle, and that's not the case. Skin thickness is the same. So the shortest needle is possible. Pen needles are 4 millimeters, and those require absolutely no pinch. Syringes are 6 millimeters, and we now have that in the hospital, too, with the safety feature for you who are injecting. Families can use the syringes that they're going to use at home if they're the ones doing it. But it's no longer recommended to pinch. It's recommended to do a two-finger lift, to just lift the fatty tissue and inject there, because doing a proper pinch can pull some of the muscle up into that pinch. And for those who are thin, you might still end up with an IM injection, even with a 6 millimeter. So, so these are the newest recommendations that can be published. For mom. monitoring, we recommend washing hands with soap and water and testing. Again, no alcohol, and hand sanitizer leaves a residue, so that can affect the meeting. It's not necessary to move from finger to finger. Kids often find their favorite few places and just use those again and again. And of course, when calluses develop, it's a little less painful. And I don't yet know what the hospital glucometer manual says in terms of first versus second drop, but for home glucometers, it's now recommended just the first drop of blood rather than the first drop and wiping and then losing a second. And we try to encourage families in the hospital not to compare between the hospital and the home meters, because there's 20% variance in a meter in and of itself, up to 20%, and between different meters. And so families can get focused on the differences between the two meters in a way that's not necessary. Using at home, they'll use it consistently and do consistent dosing based on those numbers. So. Now, when it comes to insulin pumps, there's now a variety of insulin pumps on the market. And each of these is a family of pumps, except for Omnipod. This is the only patch pump on the market right now, although I know that there are going to be others coming. I know that at least Tandem is working on a patch pump. So that's the pump. And this is where you test the blood sugar and bolus through the pump. So a lot of our kids really like that. Certainly there's the Medtronic family of pumps. I'm going to touch on a new technology, their most recent version, and then Animas and Tandem have a variety of pumps. And they're all just different features. So if you start looking at the different features of the pumps, it might be differing basal rates. So for some of our little ones, a basal rate of 0.025 is preferable than 0.05 for Omnipod, or the base for 0.1 for t-slim, because some of our little ones are really truly that sensitive to insulin when you're infusing it. They all have different types of boluses, where for pizza you can give some up front and then give the rest of the bolus over a period of time. Some have meter remotes where you can test and bolus from the meter. Others have a meter that sends the data to the pump where you bolus. So the different features are somewhat endless. And many now are integrated where the pump itself can receive data for a sensor. So that's also another feature. Many of our families don't opt to do that because Dexcom is a sensor I'm going to show you that has a share feature with. Parents can receive it on their phone, so they can see their kids' blood sugars all the time. And how pumps work is that there's always a reservoir that holds rapid-acting insulin only, usually. We never do long-acting in the reservoir. And then it's pre-programmed to have basal rates, differing basal rates. Our basal is not flat like the basal insulin. We have higher basal rates at some times of the day and lower at the rest. We can pre-program in all the different carb ratios for different times of day and the correction doses as well. And so then you go in and you blood sugar, grams of carb, and the pump knows what to do at that time, including an insulin on board feature, which will subtract out insulin for the previously bolused insulin that hasn't yet left the bloodstream based on algorithms. So it's really awesome. And then there's always a cannula. Omnipod, the patch pump, the cannula comes out through the pump itself. And sometimes they're needles. And the cannula, sometimes they're needles, sometimes they're Teflon. They can go straight in, they can go angled. So there's a variety of choices. Teflon, unfortunately, can kink, and anyone on a Teflon set will ultimately have a kink happen. And because it's usually just rapid-acting insulin for a pumper, that insulin lasts for 3 hours. So if you have a cannula kink, there's a risk of DKA within hours rather than missing at least one, if not two, of the long-acting doses of insulin for an injector. And we do have a number of some kids who choose to be what we call untethered on the pump, where they give a long-acting dose and then just use the pump to bolus for carb and blood sugar. So some of our high-risk kids, we might do that. Sometimes kids who are in lots of sports like football and disconnect for hours and hours at a time will do that as well. For pumps in the emergency room, for DKA, one of the things that we teach families is you don't bolus through the pump for DKA. For ketones at home, you inject. Now, we teach them what to do around that, injecting additional insulin above and beyond a correction. But it's true in the emergency room, if someone's in there with ketones, injections are always what you'll do. And if you remove a pump from a family, if they take the infusion set out, if you can save that for either the physician or one of the educators, we can then look at that cannula and see if it's kinked. The steel cannulas don't kink, so we have a number of kids that use them, and they're frankly quite comfortable. You wouldn't think the needle just indwelling would be comfortable, but it's quite fine if you put it in the right location. So, acute complications, hypoglycemia. You're more likely to see severe hypoglycemia, but what we technically call hypoglycemia now is less than 70. It's either not enough food for the insulin given, the insulin dose is too much, or someone did the right dose and just didn't eat enough carbohydrate and certainly exercise. And I think you all probably know signs and symptoms. Certainly there are neuroglycopenic symptoms and autonomic as well. So shaky, tired, sweaty, hungry, weak. Our kids often complain of wobbly legs and weakness and dizziness. And hungry is very common too in our pediatric population. And treatment initially is 15 grams for every 15 minutes. This is an American Diabetes Association rule. Many of our families learn to do word-rated approaches at home because certainly we teach this initially because it's the safest thing to do. But families, as they get home, especially young kids, might find that 15 grams might just shoot them too high after the fact. So they learn that at certain levels, maybe they can just do 5 or 10 grams. And then rechecking and retreating as need be. And then for emergency uses, there's always glucagon, which we teach families how to mix and inject. We also have a use for mini-dose glucagon at home to treat hypoglycemia. So kids who are sick and having nausea or vomiting and low blood sugars or just not really wanting to eat, they can mix it up and use an insulin syringe and inject a tiny mini-dose of glucagon. And for kids who are ill and vomiting, that's only a temporizing measure. Bring them into the emergency room because they probably are going to need fluid. When you're sick and not eating, you deplete your glycogen stores, and that's what glucagon does. It goes to your liver, accesses the glycogen. So, and kids have less glycogen stores than the adults do. So, again, it's only a temporary measure for that purpose. Hyperglycemia is certainly from not enough insulin or missed insulin. DKA is from insulin omission and the long-acting insulin. So if someone who's injecting comes in DKA, they've missed their long-acting insulin. You can't just miss your food coverage and go into DKA. If you're getting that long-acting every day, DKA is not going to happen. And certainly for stress, and puberty, illness, and menstruation, those are things that can affect the blood sugar and raise them. And when you have diabetes, it happens even when you do everything right. Even if you do everything the same breakfast, the same this, you still end up with results that are out of range. And so we talk about blood sugars in terms of being in range or out of range. of range. They're not good or bad. They're simply a roadmap to know how to manage diabetes. So trying to take the stigma away. And when we talk about checking blood sugar, that's what we do, is check, not test, to reduce that stigma as well. So treatment is insulin, lots of water, and ketone checking. And ketone checking at home and blood sugar checking are the keys to prevent readmissions with DKA. If those things are in place, if you're regularly checking and the blood sugar is above 300 two times in a row when you inject, or you check for ketones when you're ill, or you're above 300 just once on a pump, if you're checking and you do ketones as instructed, and then call urgently if there are moderate or large ketones, we can often manage ketones at home. So it's when those things fall out of place that most kids land back in the emergency room. Not always, because on a pump, if it keeps early in the night and you wake up in the morning, you can end up in DKA by that time too. So it's not always the case that, but certainly those things really help reduce the need for admissions. So new technologies, so sensors, you're gonna see a lot more continuous glucose monitoring coming through. And what it is basically there's this little tiny hair-like filament called the sensor. And it's inserted subcutaneously with an inserter like infusion sets are. And it dwells in the skin at least, it can often last at least a week. And often it can be restarted and used for 2 weeks. Unlike infusion sets, which lose patency because of the body's reaction, sensors actually often become more accurate with the length of use. So at least a week. And then on top of that goes a transmitter. So you can see here the sensor, which is attached to this, and the transmitter. And the transmitter is for Dexcom G5, which is the most common sensor. There's no other standalone on the market at this time. Just some that were proprietary with pumps, but that the transmitter is good for 3 months, and then they replace that every 3 months. So what it does is it reads the blood sugar every 10 seconds and gives an average every 5 minutes and updates the data. And the data can be seen on a receiver, so you can see the absolute value, you can see there's an arrow, and you can see the trends. Or it can be, the data can be sent, it can be transmitted to a phone. The phone can transmit it up to the cloud, and then the cloud can transmit it back to the parent phone. And that's called Dexcom Share, and many of our families love that. So what's really great about the sensor is that you're filling in all the gaps between all the finger sticks. It's not always 100% accurate, but it's becoming more and more accurate. And the G5 has been FDA approved for dosing of insulin with some caveats. Number one, it has to be transmitted, it has to be calibrated twice a day by finger stick, about 12 hours apart. Number two, if the arrows are going straight up or straight down when the blood sugar is changing rapidly, that's also a time to finger stick because it will be less accurate. But with that said, you know, for the most part, it can be used for dosing. And what's beautiful, there's trending arrows. It gives you the absolute, and it gives you the direction that you're going. So if you check and you're 75 and you're going up, you don't have to worry about a low blood sugar happening. Right, so it's really, and it alarms. That's the other thing, is what's beautiful is it alarms. And so often, if you set the thresholds correctly, you can prevent hypoglycemia from happening as frequently. The other thing is that the Dexcom Share, if if people are using the share feature and they get a phone app called Clarity, that can automatically send it up to the internet, to the Clarity website, and we have a portal. So when a family calls and they either upload a pump or they go through blood sugars, they can also say, you know, look at my Dexcom. So we can go look at the Dexcom download, and we can get not only these types of patterns that you see, but also kind of day-to-day and some other information that's really helpful in evaluating what's happening in between, especially when they're not using finger stick for dosing all the time, then there can be some critical data that isn't available that we can see in the Dexcom reports. Now, pumps are coming with integrated technology. There are several that receive the data, but don't do anything with it. It's